Power sequences are interesting of their own accord, but they're even more powerful if you look at their stacking. In other words, how these different rhythmic sequences stack on top of each other. Because this 1D view of the world can tell you a lot about the 3D nature of the sedimentary system that you're investigating. So here's an example of a parasequence. So in the middle here, we have the location of a well or potentially the location of an outcrop, if you're looking at outcrop. And what we can see is that we have the stacking of parasequences. So remember that the parasequences are topped with flooding surfaces. So we have parasequence 1, parasequence 2, 3, and 4 here. And what's interesting is we see that with each parasequences, we have less and less of the shelf mudstone and more of the sand, this yellow color sand. And at the last parasequence, we even have a little bit of that green facies, which represents the coastal plain. And the implication of this 1D view is profound because it is an indication that the system is prograding, because each parasequence represents the infilling of accommodation, but the stacking of these different parasequences indicates a much greater design or much greater pattern, which is one of progradation. And of course, if you are in a progradational parasequence set, it implies that you're looking at something that is probably either an HST or an LST, depending on where you are and depending on the facies that you find. So being able to look at the 1D stacking pattern of parasequences and deduct something about the 2D or 3D progradation, retrogradation, and the type of system track you're in is one of the very powerful things that this thinking in terms of parasequences brings. And at outcrop, it looks something like this. This is a picture of the Buccleuch, the Black Hawk Formation in the USA. And you can see that we have multiple parasequences, and each one of these parasequences becomes progressively more enriched in the shallow water sand. So this is a progradational parasequence set. Of course, we have other examples of parasequences. So in this case here, we have multiple parasequences, and notice that instead of becoming progressively more rich in sand, these become progressively less rich in sand, which by extension indicates retrogradation. So again, looking at the parasequence stacking pattern, we're able to deduct what the system is doing in the much larger scale, either prograding or in this case, retrograding. And there is of course also the case where each parasequence is relatively equal. We don't really change that much the proportion of the shelf mudstone to shallow marine sandstone, and that is indication of aggradation or an aggradational parasequence set. So what is the use of using parasequences, and maybe more broadly sequence stratigraphy, in trying to determine the geometry of subsurface bodies? Remember, I said in my first lecture that as stratigraphers, we're interested in understanding the geometry and distribution of subsurface formations. So let's have a look here at one example that we will interpret using both the sequence stratigraphic approach, using parasequence set, and using just lithostratigraphy. So in this example here, we have four wells. So imagine that we have well A, B, C, and D. Now, all we have as an information is this log here, the four logs of the four wells. We don't really have the connection between these different bodies. So the connection is really our interpretation. Now, if you use the parasequence set, you basically first determine what the age of your sediments are. And so you recognize flooding surfaces, and because you have independent dating, you can correlate those flooding surfaces because you know that they are timelines. So you would obtain something like this, where in blue you have those flooding surfaces, so the top of your parasequences. And so by extension, you connect the sands together, like for instance, sand number 4 with sand number 4, sand number 3 with sand number 3 in wells D, C, and B, etc. And that gives you essentially this geometry of a relatively connected body of sand, the yellow color, But of course, with some complication, because some thong of sands go and are intertonged within the basinal muds. Now, if you don't use the sequence stratigraphic approach, essentially what you do is you line up your wells based on their depth, at which depth you recover them. And then you look at the lithologies. And so you find this green coastal plain lithology that you correlate in one body. And then it gets tricky when you look at the sand bodies, because you find them in every wells, but you don't find the same number of sands, you know, in every well. You have less sand in wells A and B than in C and D. And so you end up with connecting the sand that seem to be at the same stratigraphic depth. And of course, this is the wrong approach. And it leads you to interpret sand bodies that are not connected. In your interpretation, they end up being isolated sand bodies. And that has profound implications if you try to extract resources like water or hydrocarbon from these sands, because you'll assume that they're not connected, so they are not available. And we have another example here of a not connected sand body, and a third example here of a not connected sand body. And I'll show you now the two interpretations side by side. You can see that they are extremely different. And the sequence stratigraphic interpretation is the correct one, whereas the lithostratigraphic interpretation is not. So you can see that applying the concept of parasequence set, if you have wells or outcrop, but more broadly, the sequence stratigraphic approach that we've been covering in the last two lectures, leads to a much more reasonable interpretation of the interconnection of sand bodies in this case, but any facies really in the subsurface.